Praise God. Praise the Lord. Okay, we just want to say again, welcome to this church. Welcome to the prayer line. We have an awesome, powerful word that the Lord has given tonight. But before we do so, we're going to jump right ahead. We're going to go to the question box. Okay? Praise the Lord. Remember, if you have your question, you got to just submit them. And we have to see what this person want to know. And it says, does real fasting mean to refrain from eating food, or can you fast with fruits, vegetables, etc.? Yes, yeah, somebody want to fast but want to eat at the same time. Mercy. Somebody's saying mercy. No, you see, you know, it's a tough question, because some people say you have different fasts. You have Daniel fast, you have David fast, you have all different type of fasts. Some people fast and have one meal. And I said it before, some people really don't eat breakfast, and they don't eat until probably 1, 2 o'clock. And some people fast conveniently, and then they just eat when the time when they would have been eating anyway. So it's not even a fast. You know, some people go for 10 or 20 days, and they will have one meal. I think sometimes it's a sacrifice. And if you're going to sacrifice, what does sacrifice actually mean? It's uncomfortable. It's not something you do in the norm. If you're going to fast sometimes, I know if there's a medical condition, just pray. Don't try and fast. You know what I mean? Don't try to pray if there's a to fast if there's a medical condition. Because for me, if there's a medical condition and I really dig in deep, I'm going to fast regardless. But that's me. I'm not telling us to do that. Some people fast different way. But my thing is that going through Jehoshaphat, Daniel, and a lot of them, some of them have no pleasant food. Mean it may be bread and water, or just water. It's not a nice meal you fix up and you eat a big meal and then you say you're fasting. It's between you and God. It's sacrifice have to be involved. You know what I mean? If you're doing a 20-day fast and you want to go 2 days, have a one, like a broth or something every 2 days. But don't try and do it so it's not even like you're fasting. You know, we remember last Friday night we spoke to Sister Walters, who fasted for 40 days without any water. I know I'm still getting call about it and text Sister Walters. I know she's on tonight. And people are saying, wow, that's faith. That's stepping out. You know, when Jehoshaphat called a fast, it was everyone, even the kids. You know, I mean, some people fasting and they make sure they make some big meal for their kids. Like their kids don't want salvation. You know what I mean? Like they don't want to be saved. The whole household, call a fast. If they want to cry, just say, we're praying. When Jehoshaphat called, nobody eat, neither the suckling. Nobody eat. We ain't going to die. Human don't die so easily. You know what I mean? We'll call a fast. Sorry. You know, so we like to dress it up. And we don't understand the power of fasting because we like to dress things up. But if we're going to fast and it's a sacrifice, it means we got to step out. We got to step out of the comfort zone if we want to behold Christ, if we want to see the power of God work. We can't be ordinary. So I'm not going to stand here and say when you're fasting, some people fasting for one day and say they can't do it, they can only do half a day. You know, but some people sacrifice. I remember somebody in this auditorium when they were fasting for 7 days, they sacrificed. And they thought they were going to die still, but they did not, you know. they came through. Yeah. And after that, they were empowered. And I'm sure if we call in the next 7 day, they'll be probably on top of the list. Yeah. Because it takes a little stepping out. Even when you don't think you can do it, step out in faith. That's the Christian walk. Faith. Stepping out. Not knowing what is behind the veil. So, in fasting again, it's a personal relationship. If you really want God to come through for you and want to hear from God, you can't be in your comfort zone. And some people fasting in the morning until 2 o'clock. And that's the time they usually eat anyway. Sorry. No. We have to do better. You know, it's a sacrifice. Come on, people. It's a sacrifice. So, you know, it's a sacrifice. Okay, last Sabbath, I mentioned, I didn't say it on the prayer line that I was speaking at a church in Toronto. I just invited people, but only a few people came. I went and I spoke at a church. The sermon is going to be up, Brother Shea, and the line on the YouTube channel very soon. Anyway, it was a high day there. And when the sermon was over, I shared this morning. When the sermon was over, I said, I'm not going to call an altar call. You know, it's good sometimes when you appeal to the heart. But even before you appeal, the Holy Spirit is already prompting you. And you know what you need to do. And sometimes some people can surrender without even walking to the altar. Because it's between you and God. It's not a show. So I was saying last Sabbath, anybody wants to surrender, surrender to God. And then I saw a woman walk to the altar. Boldly, I didn't even call an altar call. She was out of the gates. And she came and she knelt. And after she knelt, I saw a lot of people coming to the altar. And I had to eventually say, come then, because it wasn't an altar call. And then, when the sermon was over, she came at the door. She shook my hand and said, God sent me. And I was impressed to give her my number. So I gave her my number. And she went off. She called me a couple days after. And she told me that she had never been in a Seventh-day Adventist church. The Spirit of God moved on her and sent her and showed her the church and said, go in. As a matter of fact, when I prayed before I went to that church, the Lord says, somebody needs to hear the message you're going to take there. And I'm convinced that that's the person who's supposed to hear that message. And when she said to me that in the morning before she came there, the Spirit of the Lord gave her the same scripture, and she was repeating the scripture, holy, holy, the same scripture that I preached on. And then on Friday night, she says that. On Friday night, the Lord gave her the scripture about the locusts and about the canker worm and all these things. And it was the same sermon I preached Friday night on the prayer line. And then I'm saying, wow. And then she told me, my son is in the hospital. He's demon possessed. And I need help. So again, I asked her, how do you know that he's demon possessed? And she said, there's something in his stomach. And he get out of control and they arrested him. And then they brought him to the hospital. And she's at the hospital right away. So I said, okay, we're going to invite you today, which is Tuesday. And I'm going to pick you up at the hospital with him. And I'm going to bring you to my office and then bring you to the sanctuary where God's people are going to pray. And she says she's delighted, she's ready. She said, yes. I went, I met her, I picked her up, everything was on target. And when I was driving, I look around on the young man, he's 21 years old. And when I looked around on him, he looks a little bit different. I could see that there's a spirit right away when I looked in his eyes. And we drove and we spoke. And when he started to speak, he said that he's researching something. And when he held it up, it's the Star of David. And it's the one of the occult symbol he's looking on his phone. And I encourage him still, and I notice that whatever he's saying is really off. So I went to my office, and when we got there, he refused to come inside. So he's staying in the cold and piercing out there and would not come into the office. Because I wanted to talk to him and pray, but he recognized it's a place of prayer. Because the enemy started to manifest, you see. And we couldn't get him into the office. And I went outside and talked to him and said, listen, we're here for you. And I talked to him and reasoned with him. And after I reasoned with him, he decided he's going to come in anyway. But he came in cautious, you know, looking. And he sat down there. And I pulled the mother inside and spoke to her and said, this is a heavy case. Because when you don't want to surrender your will. Because see, God is a unique God. He's so powerful. God doesn't go against his own principle. God is a God of truth. And if God says his word says this and he's going to do this, he don't fight against our will. God will not come and deliver us unless we want to be delivered. No matter how we are demon possessed, God give us that mind, that little part. Like the man in Mark chapter 5 who ran to Christ and said, I want to be delivered. The devil would have that man run away and kill himself. But that little part of pushing. So God always leave a little space for somebody to come to say, I want to be delivered. God doesn't want to force deliverance on people. So I told the mother and said, if he can't understand and recognize, because the mom says sometimes his stomach goes way out with the spirit and comes back in. So it's real. So he said to me in the car, well, I think a spirit was in me, but it's gone. You know, but the enemy is playing defense. So finally, we're ready to get here. I decided I'm going to get somebody from the ministry to drive him here instead of me. You know, because I deal with this thing all the time, they are fearful coming around me. So he was driven here, and then when I'm driving to the church here, I met him on the way walking, and I stopped. And he said, I don't want to go in the church. I don't want to go. And I couldn't contain him. And he took off to the bus stop. And the mom went after him. So they took the bus from this far now going back. I told the mom, we're going to stay in prayer. Because once he sits at church and the enemy has such power over him, he don't want to enter into the church. So he was supposed to be here. That mother is a crying mother, a mother who loves her child, who's praying and seeking the prayers of all of us here, plus all those who are on the prayer line tonight. But I know it could have been you, it could have been me. But one thing the Lord won't do is go against our will. And sometimes we have to know how to pray and how to pray for people's will, that they will surrender and give their all. And that's why the Lord led me tonight to talk a little bit about deliverance. To talk a little bit about the power of God. The power that is in the name. The name is so powerful. I don't know if we really get it. The power of God. Let us pray. Father in heaven, great God, we come to you under your anointing again tonight. Lord, you've seen that mother who is now on the bus. Her son needs to be delivered. But Lord, the enemy is creating havoc. Many things are happening on planet Earth. But Lord, we are your children tonight. And Lord, we know that this is war that is declared upon humanity. Oh God, we pray for strength tonight. We pray for deliverance for that mother. We pray for encouragement for that mother. I pray tonight, Jesus Christ, that you will come in this place. Send your Holy Spirit here to reconsecrate this sanctuary of God and to dwell amongst us so that there will be no darkness in our presence. I thank you, praise you, exalt you. In Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Praise God. As we say, this is serious thing. This is war. The deliverance is war. The devil knows that it's short time, it's high time. And I kept appealing to God's people to get ready. And how do we get ready? Is staying in the Word, trusting in God, believing in the Word. I want you to go with me to the first scripture. I'll be going through a few scriptures here. I want you to go to Mark chapter 3, verse 27. And it says, "No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house." In other words, there's no man that can enter into a strong man's house and tie him up and steal his goods. We can't do that. Imagine Samson, physically strong, and having somebody going in to bind him and to tie him up and to rob him. Imagine that. But here the Lord is saying now, this strong man is the spiritual man. This strong man who the Lord is talking about in this scripture is Satan. And Satan is holding God's people captive in their mind, in their heart, many different ways. He's keeping God's people, and there's no way in. Satan have control. Like this young man, the enemy is trying to control his mind, his thought, his emotions, everything he does. He's trying to control him. And the Lord is saying, it's not easy to go into a strong man's house and to have the advantage. It just can't work. There's only one man that is stronger than this strong man. And his name is Jesus. I want you to go to our next scripture. Go to Luke 11, verse 21. Luke 11, verse 21. And it says, "When a strong man armed keepeth his palace, his goods are in peace." I want you to consider that. "But when a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor, wherein he trusted, and divided his spoil." It's a spiritual warfare we're talking about. We're talking about a powerful battle. And the Lord is making it clear that there's two strong persons here that is going in battle. And that's why Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10 says, "Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the rulers of darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places." It meant that this war is beyond us. The warfare that we're involving is beyond what we can see. And the Lord is breaking it down tonight and says, a strong man is in your house. And a stronger man have to come to set you free. That's the only way. And who is the stronger man? How do we know Jesus is a stronger man? How do we know? I know we can say, oh yes, because you heard that from you were growing up. Jesus is stronger. How do you know Jesus is stronger? Every Christian need to contemplate that and think about it. Think about your relationship. Think about how your faith will move if you know who is the stronger man. Who can come in and take charge and give you the victory over sin, the victory and the power? Think about it. Do you know who the strong man is? Do you know him? Whose side are you on? Is the strong man or the stronger man? No, this is something every Christian needs to contemplate. I'm going to go through some scriptures to talk about the strong man. How we know the stronger man is really powerful. I want you to go with me to 1 John 3. 1 John. We're going to go through a lot of scriptures here. And I'm just going to try finding them the same time. But this is heavy duty study here. Because you see, we have to know who Jesus really is. Because you see, that's the problem God's people having. That we don't really know who Jesus is. That he's really dominion. He's really power. He's really authority. So 1 John 3, I'll go to verse 8 and 9. And it says, he that commits sin is of the devil. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. So we know right away that Christ came to destroy the works of the devil. So he have dominion. He has power. He is the stronger man. But hear what the next verse says. Whosoever is born of God doeth not commit sin. I know somebody was asking me that question and struggling with it. I'm going to read it again. It says, whosoever is born of God doeth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. You see, that is very deep, and I've seen somebody just shaking their head. It's saying then that if we are of God, we can't sin. In other words, what the Lord was showing me is that if we get rid of sin, we will have the power to get rid of that strong man. We can call on him, and deliverance will come. But here it is. It says that if we sin, we are not of God. But the Bible also said that we were born and shapen in iniquity did our mother conceive us. But don't forget the first verse that I read there. The one that says Christ came to destroy sin. So therefore, when we accept Christ, remember when we did all the seminars on Romans, the powerful, you know, being born again and getting rid of the old man and living, you know, just arise and shine with Christ and risen with Christ. We went through all these studies. So Christ came and he conquered sin and he died for you and I. That will give us the power not to sin. So therefore, he's saying if we are born again and we are living right with him, we can't sin. No. It's deep, you know. You have to really get it. Don't mix it up with, because we are sinners. But you see, it's a deep, deep rooted, seated thing. Because God is saying, when you're thinking about what Christ done for us and that we are saved by grace, and all we have to do is claim it. We are saved by grace. So now if we are saved by grace, it's not. That's why we talk about justification. It should have been us. You know that when we present our prayers, that's why we ask that Jesus' robe just cover us. He present us just before God. That's the only way our prayers can be answered. We are hidden in Christ. So therefore, if we allow Christ to take full control of our lives and we are living for Christ, we can't sin. It's enmity. But this is deep, deep conversion, deep-seated. I see people really thinking still. Because you see, we get caught in that mindset, you know? Every day we go out, we sin. But you see, we have the tendency, though, to lean and come to Christ. You know what I'm saying? We have that tendency because we are leaning on Him. It's not our strength. We cannot do it, but it's Christ. So it's within context there the Lord is saying, listen, if you are really born again and understand what Christ done on the cross and how He rose again, and it should have been me and you. When we accept that grace, when we accept that atonement that Christ did for us, we can't sin. If we sin, we're not of Him. I mean, you look at it again and somebody says, David sinned. But God still says, David is a man after my own heart. Because you see, he sinned, but he is repentive. He's sorry. You know what I mean? He comes and he get up and say, Lord, cover me with your robe. But some people live in sin. They know it's sin. They continue. They don't want to give it up. It's part of them. We cannot represent Christ. In the last days, the Lord is saying, listen, if you want to get rid of the strong man, if you want to see deliverance, we have to know Christ. We have to get rid of sin. I'm telling you, you remember when the seven brothers went in to pray, when they see Peter and Jesus casting out the demon. You know the scripture. And when the demon says, Jesus I know and Peter, but who are you? It's saying that their lives are not matched up. They just want to do it and think it's a poetry or something. You write it off and say it and the demon will flee. You know, just call on that name. Let's call on his name, even though we don't believe him. We don't have a relationship with him, but let's call on his name and see if we can make some money off of it. We can cast this demon out. And the demon just come up and say, hey, who are you? Jesus I know and Peter. You know what I mean? Who are you? Christ is saying that the name of Jesus Christ is really powerful. It's not only calling the name, it's living the name, living the life that Jesus called us to live. And when we live that example and we stepped out and really call on the name, there is power. I'm telling you, there's power because we are living it. And that's what Christ is calling us to do, to live, have this relationship with Him. It's all about relationship. Christ is calling us to this relationship. Are we willing to get into this relationship with Christ? Philippians 2, and it says, hear what verse 9 says. It says, wherefore God also has highly exalted Him, and given Him a name which is above every name. That is above principalities. That is above witchcraft. That is above black magic. Above Freemasonry. Above the lodge. Above warlocks. Above white wizard. I'm telling you, He's given Him a name above all the name. All the powers is given to Jesus. So why won't we submit and serve Him? Then it says that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. All powers. It doesn't mean just in heaven. All powers is given to Jesus Christ, the name. So if this name is so powerful, it's not only by calling it. If we want to see deliverance, we have to have a relationship, a connection. If we want to get to that strong man, we have to have that relationship with him. And I'm telling you, if we have such relationship and step out in that name, there is power. Why so many people calling on Jesus and nothing is happening? They go to pray for somebody who's demon-possessed and call on the name of Jesus and there's nothing. It's the relationship. If we don't have a powerful connection with Christ and sin out of our lives, we cannot stand. The devil will laugh. The devil will say, who are you though? What are you doing? I remember, and I'm just saying this on as an example, because I remember I went on a mission. And when the enemy manifests in a woman, he came up to me and says, where do you get these two weaklings to come and fight me? He said that. I heard that. And I said, I bind you in Jesus' name. They are covered under the blood. But he actually said that. Where do you get these two weaklings to come and fight me? The thing is that the enemy look, he scrutinize, he dig deep and see all the weak points he can get you so he can destroy God's people. It's the same case I told you about where the same demon says, we only come out through prayer and fasting and you guys are not fasting. Yeah, they said that. So what about us with the name of Jesus Christ? The name is so powerful. Why? We have to do better. A lot of people are going to church, but we just go and say, praise the Lord, praise Jesus. It says in the verses I read before, when if we sin, we're not of God. God is calling for people to come to perfection with him. He's calling for people to confess their faults and come before Christ. If we don't do that, there's no way we can get rid of the strong man. No way. That's why we are not seeing deliverance, because we don't have a relationship with God. We can't stand. The enemy will throw us out, just as what he did with those seven brothers. Immediately, they were thrown out naked. He stripped their clothes in a couple seconds and threw them outside and said, see where power is, and just throw them out. And said, let me show you power. God is calling us and said, listen, if we have that relationship, that's why the Lord says this year is a year of restoration, revival, renewal. And this and relationship, God is calling his people to find that connection, find that relationship, because that's where the power is. That's when we're going to see deliverance and answers to prayer. We can't go and go into a warfare, because he said if there's a strong man in the house, it's going to take somebody stronger in the spiritual, even the physical. We can't get him out. Only through the blood of Jesus Christ. We can't go and say, I know the scripture, I'm coming in. You will be destroyed. You will be thrown out. I'm saying the power of God is really powerful. God is able. God is saying, tonight I'm calling his people. God is saying, I'm calling my people to a higher standard, a higher walk with him. It's all about relationship with Jesus. We have to make sure, ladies and gentlemen, that we don't just play church. We have to make sure that we don't just say we know Jesus. Because remember, those seven brothers know Jesus. They have been watching him, but for a wrong intention. They were writing down notes and see if we can cast some demon out and make some money. You know what I mean? They were making notes and say, this is what he said. And they were studying everything and say, if we do it, then it's easy. We can get away. We can make money. And I'm telling you, when they went and start, they had a shock, a surprise. The demon says, Jesus and Peter, we know, but who are you? It meant that you have no power, you have no connection, because there's only one name under the sun, the name that is above all powers, the name that is the name, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. It's the only name where all powers have to bow. If that's the case, why don't we tap into this source? If we want to see victory in our lives, if you want to defeat the strong man, why not tap in to the power source? Why come to church and we are wasting time? The days are numbered. Time are coming to an end. And the Lord is calling his people and says, come on, I want you to come higher. All powers is already given to Jesus Christ. There's only one way. One deliverance, one entry, one body, one. Only one way. James chapter 1, verse 5 says, if any man lack wisdom, let he ask God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, not wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. The point it's saying then is that God has given Jesus Christ all powers. And because we are hearers with Christ, we have access. All we have to do is ask. If we are covered under the blood of Jesus Christ and we are following him, all we have to do is ask him. And Christ will give us. He will lead us. He will empower us so that we can be victorious. So therefore, if we want to get rid of the strong man, we have to know Jesus Christ ourselves. We have to have this relationship with him. He is the stronger man that will come in. And if we don't know what to do as his children, all we have to do is ask. He will give us. He will give us the faith. He will empower us for what we need to finish the work. So therefore, the key behind this message is we have to find that relationship. Because that's the key. It's not only to know the name. Because most Christians know the name, but they have no relationship. The relationship is so key. It's the only way we're going to stand in the last days. It's the only way the work is going to finish. Because I gave the testimony about the woman that came outside with her son. And we couldn't get her to come inside. The enemy blocked him from the sanctuary. If God has empowered all of us, or some of us, or two of us, or one of us, we could go outside and raise our hand and say, in the name of Jesus Christ, come in. I'm telling you, God is so powerful. It meant that we lack some ingredients. We lack something, and God is calling us to that relationship. Sometimes, God allows things to happen so that we will wake up and start to come higher. I'm telling you. When he allows certain circumstances to happen and we realize how weak we are, that we need Jesus, then we can't remain the same. If we remain the same, trust me, might as well we just give up and come in church and get back in the world. There's going to be two sides. And that's why the Lord showed me in that scripture that there's a strong man and there's a stronger man. It's warfare. To be on the stronger man's side, we have to have the relationship. It's not about knowing about him. Everybody, even the devil, knows about Jesus. It's having the relationship. It's being obedient, giving up sin completely. That when we call, the power of God will move. Because right now we're calling, and we're just echoing. And the Lord is saying, go to this scripture. because there's war. There's so many people that needs to be delivered. But the reason why the deliverance is not coming is because people don't have that connection with Christ. We are to get to know him. And that's why the Lord showed me and broke it down. All powers is given to him in heaven and in earth. The devil knows who he is. That's why he called him by name and said, Jesus, I know, Peter, I know, but who are you? It meant we are no threat. The devil can walk in here and sit anywhere because we are no threat. We have no connection to the man who have all powers, whose name is above all names. We have no connection with him. We may think we have connection, but we don't. Because if we look deep in our lives, we're not following Christ. That's why we went to that scripture to say, if we sin, we're not of God. I'm telling you, if we sin, we're not of God. He can't defend us. That's why Psalms 91 talks about under the shadow of the Almighty. He is my refuge. He covers us with his wings. He's only covering people who have the connection. If we don't have the connection with Christ, Psalms 91 cannot even cover us. He's looking for people. This is the last days. He's looking for people who are willing and ready to come higher. And he said, I will dish it out liberally. But I'm not going to force you. I'm telling you, the young man was outside possessed. But we're not going to grab him and bring him in when he can communicate. If he was in a state where he couldn't talk, we could have muscled him up and bring him in. But he had a mind when he could rationalize and decide if he wants to Christ, he wants to be delivered or not. And it's the same way the Lord is not forcing his people. He's calling you tonight and says, I want to be your God. I want to rescue you. I want you to deliver many people. But there's something need fixing. There's something. You need to study the word more. You need to sacrifice time for fasting more. You need to spend more time with me if you really believe that I'm coming soon. He said, if you stand up for me, I will stand up for you. I want to come in, he said, and sup with you. I want to come in and reason with you. I want to have a relationship with you, but it's up to you. You have to let me in. There's a strong man and a stronger man. Who do you want to let in? Some people have the strong man in already, and there's no room for the stronger man to come in because our lives are too messed up. But God is saying there's still hope. That's why he's given me this message tonight. It's all about Jesus. He said, just read the scripture about the power that has been given to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. All powers, above all name, above all principalities, above all. That's the power. He said, under this name, demon tremble. Under this name, demon are subjected. When in Mark chapter 5, when the demon come and saw Jesus, he said, what have I to do with thee, O Son of the Most High God? I beg you that you don't cast me out in the uttermost. Cast me into the pigs. They subjected to the name. And we are heirs with Christ. We are from the same family. We are royalty. Once we are baptized and given our lives completely over, we have access to the power. But we're not claiming it. I don't know about you, but I want to claim this power tonight. I don't know about you. The world is changing. Demon possession is on the rise, so rampant. There's so many cases we're getting, and there's not enough help because we're not praying enough. Not spending enough time to get to know the man with the power. The man who distributes the power. The stronger man. We're not getting to know him. We lack faith. We doubtful, unbelief. God is saying tonight, my people, wake up. Listen to me. in order to be delivered. I have to empower you. If you go in my name, demon will have to flee. If you go in my name, there's power in my name. But it's not only going in my name. You have to know me to take on the character of Christ. You have to know me to take on the name of Jesus Christ. It's not only say you know about him. Do you really know Christ tonight? Do you know him? Do you spend enough time? I know you have friends and you spend a lot of times on the phone. You know everything about your friend. Is Jesus your friend? Do you know him? Do you really know him? It reminds me of that song, "Can't You Reach My Friend?" Do you know him? Is he your friend? Honestly. If you get to know him, life is going to be easier. I did that scripture, was it a couple mornings ago, where the men were praying, praying at the midnight? They were praying in the midnight in the jail having worship. That's the same Peter who the devil recognized and said, "Jesus, I know, and Peter, but who is the others?" It doesn't mean that he knows them, but he said, "We own you already. You can't come here to cast me out." I mean, if we're going and we're not going in the name of Jesus, the devil is going to say, "We already own you. Would you want us to embarrass you? Where are you going? Stay out of this, man. We own you already." You know what I mean? But when you come in the name of Jesus Christ and you come in, they start to tremble and said, "What have I to do? Don't get rid of us. Don't cast us out." They're afraid. But if we are no threat, they don't even see us. We can't carry on like this, where the devil thinks that we are no threat. When Christ died for us, we have royalties. We have connection. He washed us with the blood. We have privileges. We have access. Come on. Let us step out a little closer to Christ tonight. Let's really wrestle and say, "God, is there something I need to give up?" I'm telling you, if we don't do that, we're not going to see deliverance. You know what I mean? We're not going to see victory in a lot of cases because the devil don't know us. We're not even a threat. I remember sometimes when we used to go out, we used to see some powerful things. We don't even see it again. You know why? Because we're not even going out enough again. I remember one home I went to in Brompton. That young man that was here at one of the all-nighter. When I got to the door, the voice come and says, "You again, Patrick, come to mess with us again?" Because they know us. Because we prayed for so many people, they know us. Because we're always on the battlefield. But if we lay down our armor and taking it easy, there's come a time when they don't even know us again. We have to be ready. We have to be praying around the clock and asking God. Praise God. I'm telling you. So those were the days with the disciples hanging out together, Paul and Peter and Jesus. And all the demonic power knows them. Do they know you today? Do they recognize you? Are you a threat to Satan's kingdom? Why are we a Christian? Do we feel comfortable just coming to church and just seated and go home? We're going to be swept away. There's a dreadful day that is coming. Who is going to be able to stand unless we're wrapped up in Christ? I'm appealing to you tonight as I close. I'm pleading to all of us that we put on Christ. Not only know about him, we have to go into some heavy-duty study to know the word so we know how to rebuke the devil. So when the strong man come, he will recognize us and flee. It says, resist the devil, and he shall flee from us. Are you willing to resist the devil? Is that found in James 4? Resist the devil, where is that found? Resist the devil, and he will flee. How do you resist the devil? Yeah, and then draw nigh unto God. How do you do it? How do you resist the devil? It's by studying the word. It's by putting on Jesus. He's afraid of the one with the power. If we put on Jesus, it meant that we are resisting him. He will flee. But if you're just saying, you know, you're going to do things right, we have to read the word, call on the name of Jesus Christ, and the devil is going to flee. And that alone will build our relationship. We will draw nigh unto Christ. So we need to probably set up a timetable to study. You know, just organize yourself and set up probably once a day, even, you know, for a half an hour in the morning, an hour at night. And then on the weekend, you go a little bit deeper. You set up 2 hours when everyone is sleeping. This is sacrifice, you know. Because if we get to know him, we are building that relationship where God can dialogue with you, you dialogue, and it gets better. But if we are just satisfied and just living and go to church, do the Sabbath school, go back home, we don't know him. Christ spent lots of his ministry alone, isolated, praying to God. It's not collective is good at times, but there's time when you have to build that one-on-one. If you only come to church, but you don't have that one-on-one, we're not going to be able to stand. Your brother is not going to save you. Everybody is going to stand on their own in the last days. Whatever we feed our mind, the Holy Spirit is going to be able to bring it back. We need to study the word in the last days. We need to go deep in the word. We need to lock off the television. We need to lock off the TV. Just turn down everything and start to study the word. And I'm telling you, the power of God is going to work. Tonight, I'm going to pray. It's between you and God. You want to get to know Jesus more from your heart. Truly, you want to get to know Jesus. I'm telling you, I'm going slow. It's very, very deep, brethren. We have to find that connection. Because the Lord showed me today, this evening, that if we don't know Christ, not knowing about him, but know him. Because if we know him, then we believe. Our faith will increase. Our trust will increase. Because when we pray, we know he's hearing and he's there. But the only way is to feast on the word. And as we feast and dialogue in prayer and build a relationship, more and more time spent with him, then we're going to see more deliverance. And when we go out on mission, everything is going to cut shorter. When that young man was outside, we will just, two of us, go outside and just put our hands and start to pray. And then he will be broken and walk right inside. He won't just push away and just walk away. We can pray for his mind that God will touch him. God is calling his people to a higher calling. Tonight, the Lord is calling you. Do you want to come higher? Do you want to know him in that way? Do you want that relationship with him? Do you want that relationship with him? Well, tonight before I pray, it's a decision between you and God. I'm going to pray right now. Your heads are bowed. Your eyes are closed on the prayer line. We're asking God for that relationship, that oneness with him. Because we already studied that his name is above all name. The devil is afraid of him. The devil is subjected to this name. So whose side do we want to be on? He is the stronger man that is in the home. And we know there's two power that is at war. And if we don't end up on one side, we go into the other side. There's no middle grounds. And it all depends on our relationship, our walk with Him. As I pray this moment, Father in heaven, great God, you're seeing your people bowing on the prayer line. You're seeing your people bowing in this sanctuary. You've seen everything, oh God, that we want to do better. We want to come higher. Some of us want to do it, Lord, but we don't know how. Won't you allow your Holy Spirit, oh God, to touch somebody tonight and to teach us? Show us the scripture that we need to go home and study tonight. Show us the word. Show us, oh God, how to, just teach us how to pray and how to study the word. Oh God, we love you so much. We love you, Jesus. You came and you died for all of us. Lord, if it wasn't for you, we would have been dead. Oh God, you saved us so many times. I pray tonight, oh God, as you look down in your sanctuary, as you look down on your people tonight, oh God, help us, oh God, to be better. Please, oh God, only through your words. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that thy will be done now and your name will be glorified. You said, resist the devil and he shall flee from us. Prepare us, oh God, for this battle that is raging ahead, that when we accept you tonight, that we will go forth as conquerors now, praying and seeing your hands move and seeing your deliverance, because there's so many people that is wounded. Only you, Jesus Christ, can help. We submit everything to you now, our ways, our sinful state. May you reconsecrate us. May you touch us. May you heal us. May you restore us, and may you go forth with us now. We thank you, praise you, exalt you. We believe it is done. You have heard and you have answered. I'm praying in faith, believing that it is done. I thank you for hearing and answering. In Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Praise God. May the good Lord bless you and keep you. Praise God.